Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to 2016 Tang Prize Master's Forum in Biopharmaceutical Science. In the beginning, let's welcome President Yan to give us the opening remarks.
Wow, this is a full house. Yeah. It's very hard to attract so many people for basic science. Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, good morning, good afternoon. Yeah. On behalf of Taipei Medical Universities, I would like to give everyone the most welcome. And today, particularly, this the day, is our great honor to invite Dr. Jennifer Donnow to visit Taipei Medical University as her first time. And I wish that would be not the last time. Yeah. And I don't need to talk again about the Dr. Donnow's contribution in the CRISPR-Cas9 that has been announced broadly in yesterday Tang Prize ceremony, as well as from YouTube and all the broadcasting in the world. But more important is, as we all know, the human genome has been found out as a blueprint of the life, but how to editing that, how to fix that, the problem is still a question. It has been developed in many different ways to approach and answer that questions and try to fix that in a human disease. But until recently, through Dr. Donnow's effort, of course, also combination the effort from Dr. Charpentier, as well as Dr. Zhang Fang and many others now, put all the contributions into a programmable editing program, then make everything become possible. Just like you can think about it when we were young, or maybe you are too young to know that we use DOS in the computer systems, and then gradually move into the Microsoft, and this is Microsoft. On the other word, this is a breakthrough and innovation in the human genome world. And here I would like to switch the gear to talk about Dr. Jennifer Donnow. And first, believe or not, she born at Hawaii. And of course, you try to find out where is the Polynesian skin tone, which has not happened here. And Dr. Donnow graduated from Pomona, California, for her bachelor degree, and then get a PhD at a Harvard Medical School. And after that, she received a lengthy postdoc training, and most importantly, is under the instruction from the Nobel laureate, Dr. Thomas Zeck. And then furthermore, she moved to Yale to be a professor there, and happened just a few years after I left. And she's also a Howard Hughes investigator, and which is a very prestigious, and continue to have that from the age young, like a 40 to now. And besides that, she moved to Berkeley and continued to play the leadership role over there to be executive the director of the Innovative Genome Research Institute at the UC Berkeley / UCSF. And also she's heading the division of biochemistry at the UC Berkeley campus, as well as the Li Kai-shen Chancellor Chair in Biochemistry at UC Berkeley. And I don't need to say more about her contribution, because she wins so many big prizes in the past several years based on this tremendous contribution in human genome editing program. And more important, yesterday she received the Tang Prize, and which is our honor as a Taiwanese as well. And before I say more about the program, as well as the contribution from Dr. Now, I think more important is to just watch the video, and one video speaks for all itself. Thank you.
Thank you, President Yan.
For For a long time now, scientists have been working on research to understand the genetic causes for a lot of diseases. Every cell in our body contains a copy of our genome with over 20,000 genes and 3 billion letters of DNA. Emmanuel Charpentier, Jennifer Doudna, and Feng Zhang developed a CRISPR-Cas9 system that can either delete or replace unwanted genes.
With this interest, we came to the CRISPR-Cas system. We identified bioinformatically two RNAs that were expressed in asparaginase. So one is a TRACER RNA and the other one is a CRISPR RNA of the CRISPR-Cas9 system.
To look for a particular sequence of letters in the DNA code of a cell. And when the protein finds that sequence of letters,
making a cut to allow us to then replace it with a piece of DNA that's no longer able to cause the disease.
The editing, in principle, could be done outside the body by removing stem cells of the blood from a patient, correcting them outside the body.
Then we can transplant the cells back into the patient, and the cells will be able to produce new red blood cells that would cure sickle cell disease.
Unlike previous methods, it can be used to target many mutated genes at once in cancer or other diseases which involve multiple mutations.
Improved plants, we can use it to screen for new traits that confer either viral resistance or drought resistance, make crops more robust and be cultivatable even in very harsh conditions.
The opportunities with human embryo editing are enticing in a way, because one could imagine correcting a genetic disorder that would then never be transmitted to future generations.
Programmable in an easier fashion, and it's also less costly. And it's also more versatile, this is important to say, in the sense that CRISPR-Cas9 allows not only to act directly on the DNA, but also to change the expression of the DNA.
Agriculture, drug development, fighting disease, preventing congenital defects, and even curing cancer. A simple yet incredibly powerful new genetic technology, CRISPR-Cas9 system is revolutionizing today, and tomorrow is bigger than you think.
Ladies and gentlemen, please applause to the speech by laureate of 2016 Tom Prize in Biopharmaceutical Science, Jennifer A. Doudna. Let's welcome Dr. Doudna's speech.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. This is such a great pleasure to be here. Thank you very much for that incredibly generous introduction and for the warm welcome I've had really all week here in Taipei. It's been just a spectacular experience, and I'm extremely grateful and honored. And like I said yesterday, I could have never imagined standing here today when I was a girl growing up in Hawaii and, you know, dreaming about becoming a scientist and becoming a biochemist. I just wanted to, you know, pursue my passion and my interest in how nature worked, and I could never have predicted where it led me today. And so what I thought I would do in this talk is walk you through some of the science that we've been working on over the last few years and how we came to the CRISPR-Cas9 technology, and then talk to you a bit about where I see this all going. And I think this will hopefully lead to a very interesting discussion afterwards. And I'm especially interested to hear your thoughts and your questions as we get into the discussion about how you think this will be used in human health and perhaps other areas that you're thinking about as well. So, you know, I thought I would start by just pointing out something that I'm sure everyone here is familiar with, but the idea that, you know, DNA is really the fundamental way of encoding genetic information in cells. And I think it's really the stemming from the original discovery of the structure of DNA, the DNA double helix, that was determined back in the 1950s. That certainly has inspired many scientists over the last few decades to think about the amazing possibility of being able to change the DNA sequence in cells in a precise fashion. What if you could actually have a technology or a tool that would allow you to make a very specific alteration to the DNA sequence in cells in such a way that you could either study the function of a particular gene or set of genes, or you could correct a mutation that would otherwise cause disease. And so the idea really has been, you know, what if you could think about DNA the way we think about the text of a document, where you could understand what all of the letters and sentences in the DNA of a cell are telling us about the way that an organism is put together. And certainly this, I think, was the original dream of sequencing the human genome and many other organism genomes, was to be able to have that kind of information. And so, as you know, we've had, you know, since 1995, when the first entire bacterial genome was sequenced, there now are thousands of whole genome sequences for many different organisms, including us. And so then the question becomes, how do we really understand? How do we make sense of that information? And furthermore, how do we rewrite that information? So if we see evidence for a mutation that causes disease, wouldn't it be great if we had a way to very precisely correct that mutation? And that's sort of, you know, been almost a science fiction-y kind of fantasy for a long time. And I think what's really exciting right now in biology is that you know, with the convergence of a number of technologies, including the one that we're talking about today for gene editing in cells, it's now possible to do that. It's now possible to understand what the information in DNA is telling us about the function of a cell or an entire organism, and not only that, to really be able to manipulate that information in ways that, as researchers, will tell us more about biology, and as clinicians, will allow us to make changes that will have real impact on patients in the future. So it really is a very, very exciting time in biology, and a great opportunity for all of you that are students starting out to be starting your careers at a moment, in a way, when there are so many tools at your fingertips to do exciting work. And so what I wanted to really express to you is something that I think is worth appreciating, which is where this gene editing technology came from. And from the work that we've done in my lab, you'll see that this is really a project that began with a fundamental curiosity about biology. So it didn't start with an effort to figure out or discover a new technology. It really started with a collaborative, international collaborative project that was aimed at answering a very different kind of question, which was namely, figure out how bacteria fight the flu or fight viral infection. And so to give you a little bit of a backdrop to this, so you may know that, you know, the origins of molecular biology from a few decades ago started in many ways with the study of bacteria. And not only bacteria, but also the viruses that infect bacteria. And this is just showing a slide that illustrates the way that these infections work. So this is a bacteriophage, a virus that has DNA packaged in the phage head right here. And when this virus lands on the surface of a bacterial cell, the first thing it does is to inject its genetic material, its DNA, into the cell. And so at that moment, you know, these bacterial cells typically have a very short period of time to defend themselves from the virus before they're destroyed by it. And so there's a very strong evolutionary selective pressure for cells to evolve ways to fight these kinds of viral infections. And so the scientists have been investigating these mechanisms for a long time, and you may know that one of the major tools of molecular biology, namely restriction enzymes, which are enzymes that have the ability to recognize and cut specific sequences of DNA, those actually came originally from bacteria and from systems in bacteria that have evolved to fight viral infection. And it turns out that the CRISPR systems are yet another way that bacteria have for fighting off viruses. Now, these systems came to the attention of scientists sort of gradually. So I think the first paper that has been found in the scientific literature reporting evidence of these CRISPR systems in bacteria comes from a lab in Japan in 1987. And then it took a number of years before that initial observation was followed up by other people to try to understand what these systems might be and how they might work. And so CRISPR systems came to my attention about 10 years ago, in the mid-2000s, when a colleague of mine at UC Berkeley, Jill Banfield, who's shown right here, called me up one day in my office at Berkeley and told me that her research had uncovered a very interesting pattern of DNA sequences in bacterial cells. And so her laboratory works on environmental bacteria that are growing in various interesting environmental niches, like acid mine tailings, where they have, these are organisms that survive at pH 1 and things like that. And so the way her lab investigates these organisms is not by culturing them in the lab, but actually just by collecting samples of these organisms and sequencing all of the DNA in the cells and any viral DNA that is found together with them. And her research had doing that kind of metagenomic sequencing had uncovered an interesting observation, which was that many of those organisms had in their genome, and I'm showing you here just a cartoon of a bacterial chromosome, and inside the chromosome, and many of these organisms were repetitive DNA sequences that had a very distinctive pattern that occurred again and again. So it seemed like they were being somehow maintained in these cells. And the pattern was a series of repeats that's shown here by the black diamonds of about 40 base pairs in length, repeated sequences of DNA that occurred again and again. And in between were sequences of DNA about the same length that were shown in 2005 in these three publications to be derived from viruses. And so this was the first hint that these sequences might in fact be some kind of adaptive immune system in bacteria, some way that bacteria could store little pieces of viral DNA in the genome and perhaps use that information later to protect the cells. And what hinted that this might be a real system in bacteria was the fact that nearby in the genome were typically CRISPR-associated or Cas genes. So of course, these had come to be called CRISPRs, which is an acronym that is short for clusters of regularly interspaced short palindromic repeats. I try to say that 5 times fast. And so these sequences very typically occurred with genes that were associated with them. And so it really looked like some kind of highly conserved mechanism that might be employed in cells to provide protection from viruses. But at the time, nobody knew how they might work. And so why did Jill call me? And the reason is that, you know, my lab has had a long-standing interest for really since I was a graduate student and then a postdoc in understanding the function of RNA molecules in biology, namely molecules that are made, that are copies of DNA that function in cells to do interesting things. And I just very briefly wanted to illustrate this by showing, this is sort of what we learn in high school, maybe even in elementary school these days, I guess, as the central dogma of molecular biology, which is basically the flow of genetic information, which goes from DNA over here, that is the repository of genetic information in virtually all organisms, with the exception of some viruses that have RNA genomes. And then this information is transcribed into RNA. And if this RNA is coming from a gene in the genome, then this can be translated into proteins. And so this is really how genetic information flows. And of course, grossly oversimplified, you probably know that in many cases it can go backwards, and there can be other sorts of manipulations that happen that change information in cells. But this is kind of fundamentally the flow from DNA to RNA to proteins. And my lab has always been interested in phenomena like this, where segments of DNA are transcribed into RNA, and then the RNA itself is the functional molecule. So rather than acting as a messenger that encodes a protein, actually many RNAs we now understand are functional in their own right. They are either functional as catalysts or they do other things in cells. They work with proteins to do things. And one of the ways that they often function, and this was one of the really important discoveries in sort of the very late 1990s, was the finding that many cells use very small RNAs as a mechanism of controlling the expression of information from the genome. And this is, of course, the process called RNA interference, or RNAi. And so in my lab at Berkeley, we had been investigating the molecular basis for RNAi, RNA interference. And so when Jill contacted me, I thought, wouldn't it be amazing if bacteria have come up with some way of using RNA to control the expression of information, in this case, to control viruses, but using entirely different machinery than what's used in animal cells or plant cells for RNA interference. And that was really how we got involved in all of this. And so one thing led to another, and you know, I started to work on this with just a couple of initial students that came to the lab that were adventurous and wanted to explore this proposed bacterial adaptive immune system. And what emerged over the next number of years from labs around the world who started to investigate this was not only was this an adaptive immune system, but there were many different types of CRISPR systems. And in 2011, I went to a meeting in Puerto Rico and I met Emmanuelle Charpentier for the first time. And so she and I were coming from very different scientific backgrounds. We were in different parts of the world. She was working in Sweden at the time. She was trained as a medical microbiologist and studying bacteria that cause infection in humans. And my lab, of course, was, you know, a fundamental science lab working on the function of RNA in cells, and we'd already been working on CRISPR systems for a few years at that point. And we teamed up to figure out the function of a particular gene in some types of CRISPR systems called Cas9 that had been shown genetically at the time to be essential for protecting cells that had this Cas9 gene from viral infection. And nobody knew how it could do that. How did it actually work? And so we worked together to answer that question. And what our research uncovered was that, in fact, the Cas9 protein is an amazing little machine. And I thought I would show you just a 3D printed model of Cas9. So this is a model that sits on my desk in Berkeley. It's about the size of a soccer ball, roughly. It's about this big. And it's 3D printed on a 3D printer based on crystallographic coordinates that show us where all the atoms are located in the Cas9 protein in the RNA that's used, which is the orange molecule in this printed model, and the DNA that it recognizes in blue. So let me just briefly walk you through this image and tell you what this is telling us about how it works. So the protein is in white, the Cas9 protein. And it's an amazing molecule that holds on to RNA, which is the orange molecule here. And you have to remember what I told you about these CRISPR loci in bacteria. So in bacteria, a bacterium would have stored a piece of viral DNA in the CRISPR locus, and then that DNA copy of the virus is turned into an RNA copy by transcription. And then each of those RNAs that would have a piece of a viral sequence inserted into it is able to then bind to Cas9, this protein, and of course there are many, many molecules of the protein around, so each Cas9 protein in the bacterium might be guided by a different guide RNA that could recognize a different virus or a different piece of a virus. And then these really function as a sort of a sentinel in the cell that goes searching through DNA, and if they find a match, if they find a matching sequence that matches part of the guide RNA, then this kind of interaction that you're seeing right here occurs, where the protein literally grabs onto the DNA double helix in blue and unwinds the DNA inside the protein to allow an RNA-DNA hybrid to form. So it's an RNA-DNA helix that forms inside the protein. That's the basis for recognition of a DNA sequence. And when that happens, it triggers this protein to change its shape and position two molecular blades, two active sites in the protein in place so that they can actually cut the DNA. And so in a bacterium, this is a great way to cleave and eventually destroy viral DNAs that match this sequence of this guide RNA, which tells the cell, I've seen this virus before, I've stored its sequence in my genome, and now I see it again and I'm gonna get rid of it. Okay, so for bacteria, it's a great way to protect against viral infection. But we realized when we had figured this out about how this protein worked, this was kind of for us the moment when this project went from being a fundamental curiosity-driven project to realizing that this could be actually an incredibly powerful technology. And to explain where that thinking came from, I have to tell you about this, which is that in parallel with the very very sleepy, quiet field of CRISPR biology at that time, was a large body of work that was going on elsewhere in the scientific world by people who were studying how DNA gets repaired in animal and plant cells, and also how one could use various kinds of engineered proteins to trigger specific kinds of DNA repair. And I wanted to show you this slide just to illustrate that what had been appreciated from really a couple of several decades of research was that in animal and plant cells, when DNA of the genome experiences a double-stranded break, something that happens a lot during cell division or could happen due to random radiation or chemical damage to the DNA, if a double-stranded break occurs, the cell has ways of repairing the break to avoid catastrophic damage to the genome. And these pathways involve either sealing up the gap, often with a small change that gets introduced in the DNA sequence right at the site where the repair occurs, or sometimes by actually recombining in a new piece of DNA at the site of the break. And so many scientists had appreciated that if you had a way to introduce a double-stranded break into the genome at precisely the place where you might like to make a change to the DNA sequence, this could be a powerful way to conduct genome engineering. And so we recognize that by programming the Cas9 protein with RNAs of choice, so you could, because we knew how it worked, we could actually design guide RNAs that would direct the Cas9 protein to a DNA sequence of interest, for example, a site where you knew that there was a mutation in the genome that you might like to correct, that this could actually be employed as a technology that would introduce double-stranded breaks at precisely the place where you might like to induce cells to repair the DNA in a specific way. So let me show you a very brief video that just illustrates how we imagine that this might operate inside of an animal or a plant cell. And this just shows zooming into a eukaryotic cell, so a cell that has its DNA encapsulated inside of the nucleus. And once this bacterial protein RNA complex gets into the nucleus, it encounters DNA that's packaged in chromatin, so wrapped around these green histone proteins. Somehow, this Cas9 complex has to search through the DNA of the cell to find, in principle, a single sequence that matches the letters in the guide RNA that this protein contains. And when that happens, it unwinds the DNA, cuts it, and then hands off the broken ends of two repair enzymes in the cell that can seal the break, sometimes by incorporating a new segment of DNA, in this example, at the site of the break. So a way to precisely alter the DNA sequence in cells. And what's been really remarkable is that since we published this work and the idea of using this system in 2012, so we're now just a little over 4 years after publication of that work, there are now well over 1,000 papers in the literature in which labs around the world have been able to adapt this technology for use in all sorts of different kinds of systems, animal cells, plant cells, fungi, other bacteria, et cetera. So it really seems to be a very system that really operates in essentially any kind of cell where it's been tested. And so I won't show you here, but I spoke about in the Laureate lecture some of the things that we're doing in our own lab to figure out how this really works. I think that's a fascinating question, is how is it that this protein really functions as an RNA-guided DNA targeting system. But I want to just now, in the last couple of minutes, just turn to how it's being applied. And I wanted to point out that there are many exciting applications in animal systems. So it's been possible now to generate strains of mice that have modifications much more quickly than was possible by older technologies. And of course, other kinds of animals that are being used as models of human disease to allow study of human physiology, as well as the effect of potential therapeutics that could be beneficial for human health. And then I think, you know, going forward, we're seeing increasing efforts to engineer stem cells and other kinds of patient-derived cells that could be beneficial for real therapeutics. And I think what's coming in the probably not too distant future are going to be opportunities to really introduce these engineered cells back into patients, and potentially one day even to think about how you might introduce these editing complexes into a patient from the get-go and induce tissue-specific kinds of editing that would be therapeutically beneficial. It's really a kind of an amazing thing to think that we now have a technology that will one day be useful in that way. And I also want to point out that, as mentioned before, this is a technology that's broadly applicable in different kinds of organisms. So in addition to being used in animals and in models of human disease, there's also lots of work that's going on in agriculture. This was taken from a recent paper that was published in Nature magazine about a CRISPR mushroom. And this was actually work that was done at Penn State University in the US, in which scientists were able to use the CRISPR technology to target a specific gene that causes mushrooms to turn brown when you cut them. And by knocking out that gene, you wipe out that browning effect in mushrooms, I guess useful for selling if you want to sell more mushrooms. And the reason this was published in, and this article was written in Nature magazine, was that the US Department of Agriculture actually decided that this kind of editing in plants is not considered genetically modified. So there's no introduction of foreign DNA here, simply a precise knockout of a natural gene in this mushroom. And so at least in the United States, this type of editing is not considered genetic modification. So, this has sort of been fascinating for me to learn more about this. Of course, in different countries in Europe, this would be considered genetically modified. So, you know, it comes down to the way that people define this sort of thing. And so there's now, of course, very active discussion about this in various countries. And I can tell you that certainly in the US, there are a number of other sorts of plants and plant-derived products that are in the pipeline that are being produced also with this kind of gene editing technology. So very active interest in thinking about this and, of course, educating people about what this really means so they can decide, is this something that we want to have? Do we trust this? And I think that was one of the real issues real fiasco with GMOs in the past, was that there wasn't transparent discussion of what this was and why people should think about the potential benefits of these types of organisms. And then I wanted to just end by mentioning that, I think that one of the applications that's in a way most intriguing about gene editing is the idea that we could actually use this sort of approach in embryos and in human embryos. And this is showing an example. This is not human embryo editing, by the way. This is a slide I got from my colleague at Berkeley, Russell Vance. This is actually doing editing in a mouse egg. So what I'm showing you here is a pipette that's holding this egg and a needle going in that's actually injecting molecules of Cas9 with its guide RNA that would allow editing of a particular gene in this fertilized egg. And of course, if the editing is done very, very early in embryogenesis like this, then in principle, every cell of the resulting animal that were to develop from this fertilized egg has the editing modification that was introduced very early. And furthermore, those changes are transmitted to the future generations because that animal's germ cells then contain that modification. So if you think about doing that in humans, then it provides an opportunity to remove genetic mutations permanently, potentially, from the human species, which is sort of a profound thing to think about. And then there's also the opportunity to introduce changes that are not medically necessary, but might be considered desirable for some reason. And so, this was something that I had been sort of thinking about maybe in the back of my mind as a possibility, but it really came to the fore for me when early, I think it was around February of 2014, a paper was published showing that you could do this in monkey embryos and that the resulting monkeys that developed were perfectly normal, but they had changes to their germline and to all the cells of the animal that were introduced by the Cas9 guide RNA editing that occurred in embryogenesis. So I thought, boy, if you can do that in monkeys, why not in humans? And maybe somebody will. And so that really was my motivation for beginning to get very involved in discussions around the ethical use of this technology and thinking, trying to get involved in educating people very broadly about this and encouraging scientists to get out of the lab and really talk about it and think together globally about how do we make use of a very powerful, important technology that also has potential ethical implications that might be concerning, and that we don't want to have this technology moving ahead faster than we've had time to really think about. And this is my last slide, which is really just taken from the cover of, this is literally from the cover of The Economist magazine published last year, where the title was Editing Humanity, and they really pointed out that, you know, there's the potential in the future for people to think about making changes to their children that that could be introduced using a precise genome editing technology like this. And of course, today you probably know that we don't have the ability to really do this because we don't know enough about the genetics underlying these kinds of traits. But over time, we'll learn more, and it may become increasingly possible to make changes that we think might give our children a benefit in the future. And we really have to ask, do we want to go there? And if we do, how do we ensure that it's done in a way that's ethical and fair? And so I'll end there. I'm looking forward to the discussion. And I just want to mention that, as was said in the introduction, I've been involved in creating the Innovative Genomics Initiative in the Bay Area. It's a partnership between UC Berkeley, which does not have a medical school, and our sister medical school across the bay, UCSF. And so this has been a great opportunity for somebody like me that does fundamental research to partner with clinical laboratories and really think hard about how we can help clinicians to apply this technology in ways that will be medically beneficial in the future. Check us out on the web if you want, or come visit if you come to the Bay Area. And finally, I just really wanted to thank my laboratory. This is a picture taken at a recent Giants game in San Francisco, baseball game. And it's a great group, international team, people from many countries that come together to do science at Berkeley, and it's been a real pleasure to work with these talented people. We've also had terrific collaborations. I've mentioned some of them here, of course, Emmanuel, but also more recently, Gene Yeo at UC San Diego, and my colleagues at Berkeley, Evan Ogalis, Jamie Cade, and I think Robert Tijan is maybe cut off the bottom here, but he's also been a great collaborator of ours. And then we couldn't do anything without funding, so very grateful for our funding sources. And finally, I just want to mention company connections that I have, and I'll stop there and be happy to address questions. Thank you.
Thank you for the amazing sharing by Dr. Jennifer Dana. And at this time, we will begin the forum. I would also like to invite our guest, Academician Gong Xingjian, Director of Agriculture Biotechnology Research Center, Dr. Shi Mingzhe, Chairman of Research Genovate Biotechnology, Dr. Chen Zhen, and President Yan Yun from TMU. Please have a seat. During the forum, the audience is welcome to write down their questions on the sheet that was given at the entrance. And please pass it to our staff. We will announce the questions. And now, I would like to invite President Yan to begin the forum.
Yeah, thank you. It's a great honor to run this forum, and also in the meantime, we are sorting and collecting the Q questions. So maybe I just kick off a very simple and interesting life-related question, not science-related. I know the Time magazines list you and Dr. Charpentier among the 100 most influential people in the world. I think this probably knocked your life down completely, up and down, I believe. So do you want to elaborate a little bit about what's your life changes from past several years ago until now?
Well, you raise an interesting question. I mean, I think for all of us that are doing science, you never sort of imagine that your work will go in this kind of a direction. I can tell you I certainly did not. And but I feel like you know, it's been an incredible educational experience for me. It still is. I'm learning a huge amount right now. I feel like a student again, which is actually really fun. And you know, and I have an incredible opportunity to meet scientists and others around the world who I would have not had the chance to interact with otherwise. So I try to embrace that. You know, but it's a challenge because I think that, you know, there's really so much demand right now for people to learn about this technology. And so the challenge is to continue to do science, which is what I do and what I love to do, and I feel a responsibility, of course, to continue working with my students in the laboratory, but also to take the time that's necessary to interact with people like government regulatory agencies and others who are coming forward to try to understand what this means for them and what it means for, you know, our societies and how we think about this technology together. So it's a, you know, it's a constant balancing act, and I don't always get it right, but, you know, I really just feel honored to, honestly, to be part of it.
Great. So you are still remain a native scientist rather than a celebrity yet. Yeah, but you are going to collect lots of signature from everybody here. Yeah. So do we have questions ready? Yeah. If not, let me ask another question. That would be general question. Maybe all the general question to me, and all the, you know, smart question go to the others, the discussants. So I know the ethical line is critical at this moment because we talk about editing gene and editing life. So do you think we should manage these IP carefully as a beginning the source and then control the ethical issues? So that's kind of a bundle together now. So what's your opinion about this in regard?
Well, here's the thing that I think is so interesting about this technology, and that is that one of the reasons that it's taken off as fast as it has worldwide is that it's pretty easy to use, frankly. You know, we now have, you know, we have high school students that come into the lab, and within a few weeks they can be editing human cells in the laboratory with this. It's you know, we recently held a little one-day lab at UC San Francisco with Mark Zuckerberg and his wife Priscilla Chan, and they came in and within 6 hours they did a little editing experiment that had been set up for them. So, you know, it's something that is widely accessible to people. And so I think this is great because it means that, you know, it's enabling researchers around the world to do experiments they couldn't have done in the past, to work on many different kinds of systems. And this is completely independent of any intellectual property, right? Because we're all just employing the technology in the laboratory for you know, a wide variety of applications. I think where the intellectual property comes in is when, in the future, when companies want to commercialize products that they're generating using this technology, then you know, the established procedure is they need to figure out who owns the intellectual property. Where do they need to get a license so that they have either freedom to operate or freedom to sell and make a profit from those products? And so, you know, hopefully at that point in time when that comes to pass, the intellectual property will have been sorted out and they can figure out who to get a license from. But the good news is, I don't think this is in any way inhibiting science and research from proceeding at the moment, which is what's really important to me.
Great, thanks, Jennifer. Also, let me invite our discussants to participate in this conversation. Maybe start from my left hand, President Chen, especially you are expert in the IP issues.
No, actually, from the pharma guy, I think the IP, just like Jim said, it's very important when you get into the commercialization stage. Before I came, actually, I did a search on CRISPR-Cas9, actually, patent coverage, for example. It turns out the published patent application right now is about 500 or 600. Actually, it's not that many. Yeah, then you can see some of them probably belongs to Jen, and some of them belongs to the other scientists. But altogether, actually, one thing come to my mind is eventually, probably, there's no single group can have a dominating, actually, power to a particular technology in this CRISPR-Cas area. So in my mind, probably eventually when you go into the commercialization, it's kind of the cross-licensing between each other. Yeah, more collaborative rather than kind of barrier to inhibit other people to use it when you come to the commercialization. It's kind of a little bit different here. In fact, if you consider Jim as a basic scientist, actually that's wrong. The last slide you notice, if you will, actually sponsored by Pfizer, also a few other companies. In fact, Jen also is the founder of several biotech companies. Some of them actually went IPO with the market cap today over $1 billion. Okay, so she is not actually a scientist. She's also a very, very outstanding entrepreneur. I think this part we probably need to learn more from her. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you. I think this is very critical to Taiwan, especially at this moment. How the academician involved into the entrepreneur. We are encouraging, but where's the limit? Yeah, but you can also comment later. I would like to, at this moment, invite the academician Kang to give his point of view.
My feeling is that quite often, the academicians and those who are interested in the industrial connection actually have a fundamental conflict in terms of their concepts of doing things. And one case in point is myself and my brother. Yeah, he was trying to teach me how to get into the industry and got very frustrated. So maybe I can turn this as a question to Jennifer in terms of how the school sometimes can encourage this kind of thing. We live in a very different era now. I remember when I was a postdoc at the UCSF, Mike Bishop's lab, Herbert Boyer just upstairs. And at that time, the UC system is still quite reluctant in terms of the involvement with industry. But then with the Genentech, it opened up the way, but still not fully. So I'd like to perhaps ask Jennifer how UC system, what is your experience in the starting up a company?
Well, I think the UC system did something very smart a few years ago, and that was, and really we owe a lot of credit also to the former governor of California, who realized that there was an incredible opportunity to take what is a great public university system in the U.S., the University of California, and to create a way for discoveries coming out of the research labs at these universities to be commercialized in ways that would solve real problems and also create jobs and create businesses, spur economic activity in our state. And so what was done was to actually create something called the QB3 Institute, which is a virtual institute. It doesn't have an actual sort of home, except that it lives on three particular University of California campuses, UC Berkeley, UC San Francisco across the bay, and UC Santa Cruz, which is just down the coast. And what this does and what it means for us and why it's relevant to your question is that one of the things that QB3 did was to create a pipeline for professors to start companies, and not only to start them, but also to get the kind of assistance they would need to do that. So somebody like me, going into this, I knew 4 years ago, believe me, I knew really nothing about starting a company. But we had the idea that, this technology and some of the, actually this was even before the Cas9 work, we realized that some of the enzymes, the proteins in these CRISPR pathways could be very useful as tools. And so in 2011, I founded a company with a then graduate student in my lab, Rachel Harwitz, called Caribou Biosciences. And we were able to do it using the QB3 mechanism. So we had free legal assistance to incorporate our company, and we got help finding laboratory space called Garage Space that was in my building at Berkeley. So we rented very inexpensively a small lab for this company. And furthermore, they helped us write grants to the government to get initial funding for the company. And this was all really key to allowing somebody like me that had no business experience at all to found the first company that we got involved with. And it was great because it employed a student. So Rachel graduated from my lab. She became the head of this company. She still is. And now we've hired, now the company has grown to 40 people. So we now have 40 people that all have jobs because that company was created. And it's gonna, you know, it'll continue. And so this is something that many of my colleagues at the University of California have found to be, you know, highly beneficial for allowing scientists and you know, people doing fundamental research to allow their discoveries and their inventions to be harnessed by companies for commercialization.
I just have a very quick follow-up. So does UC Berkeley or UC system in general would give this sabbatical leave time for those who may want to get more involved in company, to faculty?
So. Yeah, they do. So, you know, for faculty who really want to work with their company directly, they maybe want to spend full time there. So we're, you know, as professors, we're allowed to spend one day a week with companies. And that's, you know, part of university policy. But if you want, what if you want to do more than that? Well, then you can take a leave of absence. You could do a sabbatical, but you could also take a leave, in which case you can actually spend full time at a company and maintain your appointment, your faculty position at the university, but take some time away to go and help the company to grow. And sometimes I've known many colleagues that have done this sort of thing, and it goes both ways. Sometimes they go for a while and they come back, and sometimes they go and they love it so much they don't come back.
Thank you. Maybe we invite Dr. Shi to give a comment.
I have a little bit different questions. We prem biologists tend to believe science can make you rich, also can do good. And so it's also much easier to make transgenic plant than transgenic animal. So, but since Cas9 system is so powerful and we think it can actually revolutionize how we make agricultural crops and so on, but we also are afraid our golden rice nightmare to reoccur. I don't know whether the student know the golden rice, which was a transgenic rice created by a Swiss scientist in early 90s. His goal was to, in the Africa population, there's a vitamin deficiency, and which you cannot give vitamin to African populations because they only have $1 or $2 a day. You even give them vitamin pill, they won't take it. So this scientist created this transgenic rice with higher amount of the vitamin A. The problem is the transgenic rice involve so many different patents. And so this creator need to convince this company, say, because the agricultural products tend to affect larger population, but they don't have market value. So he convinced every company except one company. This company wouldn't give up patent. The patent is just for a promoter. In the early 90s, you can patent everything. A piece of DNA with 100 base pair promoter sequence, you can patent it. And unfortunately, that plasmid has this patent. So the rice was created in 1990s. It still haven't distributed to Africa populations up until now. So do you think this nightmare will reoccur, and how do we solve it if we use, say, CRISPR technology to create, say, nowadays I think Bill Gates Foundation want to spend a lot of money create nutrient-rich cassavas and rice for Africa population. So how do we deal with this problem?
Yeah, so my understanding of golden rice is that it's maybe even more complicated than what you explained, right? Because there were also regulatory challenges, and there were also questions about public acceptance of this rice. And so, you know, I think there were sort of multiple reasons why it has unfortunately sat on a shelf for many, many years, despite the potentially huge impact on human health that it could have. I think going forward, you know, this is certainly one of my personal motivations, is to really try to take a different path than was taken originally with genetically modified plants. I think, you know, some of the resentment that has built up is due to the fact that a company, a multinational company called Monsanto, was, you know, involved in some early modifications to plants that were viewed as, you know, really motivated by profit for the company rather than benefit to human societies. And so I think that, you know, one of the potentially good things about having an organization like the Gates Foundation involved is that, you know, they're not out for commercial benefit. They're trying to do things that are going to impact positively on human societies. And, but of course, this goes hand in hand with, I think, education and with, you know, people like us, like all of us, and certainly scientists being open and transparent about what we're doing, what our motivations are, what our conflicts of interest are, and inviting a global discussion, because I think that's really, in the end, the only hope we have that people will accept these sorts of things and be willing to invite them into their societies and into their lives.
Yeah, thank you, Jennifer. Since we have too many questions on my hand and lots of coming, so maybe I will change it a little bit. I will raise the question, and Jennifer, you can answer that, and also all the discussants can participate. How about that? So I think several medical students and PhD students raised a similar question about whether CRISPR-Cas9 may cause the off-target effect, literally mutation. So that may cause some concern. So you have any particular answer for that, especially for these young generations? Yeah, they are going to use that. Yeah.
Well, you know, I think one thing that I've found really interesting that's come out of our own research, but also from talking to various laboratories around the world that are using the CRISPR technology in different kinds of cells, is that it's actually remarkably accurate. It's not perfect, but it's remarkably accurate. I think it has evolved in bacteria. It has to be good at finding targets and avoiding off targets to avoid, you know, killing bacterial cells. And when scientists have been using this technology in primary cells, so rather than in cancer cell lines, as was done in a lot of the early work, which frankly, you know, may have defective DNA repair pathways, have multiple copies of genes, multiple chromosomes, et cetera. If you use them in primary cells, primary tissues, what various labs are finding is that it's actually pretty hard to detect off targets, especially if these editing molecules are used in very modest amounts. Turns out you don't need to use a lot, right? You need one editing event and that's it. So that's one thing. And we've also found, and this is again work of Stephen Lin when he was in my lab, and he's now here in Taiwan at Academia Sinica, is that by using non-genetically encoded Cas9, namely pre-assembled protein RNA complexes for editing, editing occurs very quickly in cells, and then those complexes are subsequently degraded by the cells, leaving behind no molecules that can continue to do editing or off-target editing over time. So I think those are things that are worth thinking about. But, you know, going forward, you know, I think one thing you may all be aware of is that the field is still very rapidly evolving, right? So new CRISPR-related proteins are being found, new ways of modifying the original Cas9 and its cousins are being used and employed to ensure accuracy of targeting. So I think, you know, I don't really see that as a bottleneck at this point with this technology. I think that it's already pretty good and it's going to get even better over time.
Thank you, Xin Jian or Dr. Xi, you have anything, okay? Yeah, yes, please, President Chen.
Yeah, actually, everything's about risk and benefit. I mean, I also have like two questions here related to the similar field. For example, in China, there are four clinical trials ongoing. If you are going after, yes, there may be some off targets, but if you're going after like terminal ill cancer patients, so their life probably can only last for another 3 to 6 months. For example, in China, these four trials, one in Chengdu, the other one, three actually in Beijing, they are going after terminal ill patients for lung cancer, renal cancer, bladder cancer, and prostate cancer. So for example, in US, they are also going after like those HIV patients. So I think, yes, eventually you may go after those super baby like Jennifer mentioned, that's a long, long way from here. However, going after some life-threatening terminal ill patient to practice this on target, off target, I think also a lot of engineering involved, also scale up involved, a lot of actually manufacture regulatory. But start from today, I fully agree with Jim. Actually, eventually, risk benefit will balance it out, and gradually, will more application come out naturally.
Thank you. Yeah, here's again, these all the students raised the question. It's wonderful. Similar questions. Question is the disease involves the whole body. So how you deliver the CRISPR-Cas9 into it, and how you can recognize this kind of a specific receptor and bind with that? This outstanding question from medical school first year. Wow, yeah. Impressive. We have a good student here. Yeah.
Well, I'll give you my thoughts, but I'd love to hear my colleagues' thoughts as well. But basically, I think that, you know, you've put your finger on one of the really important future challenges for this technology. Works very well in the laboratory. That's been shown over and over. But how do you actually deliver it into a whole organism, whether it's a whole person or a whole plant? Or I think this is a really big challenge going forward. And as you probably know, it's not a challenge just for gene editing technology, but it's also a challenge for any kind of therapeutic that you have. How do you deliver it if it's an antibody or something else? And so I think one of the things that I find really interesting and kind of exciting right now is that there has been a lot of research done on delivery and delivery of nucleic acids, especially with RNAi-based therapies, but also delivery of proteins. For antibody therapies. And so we're fortunate that this technology is coming along at a moment when there's already a lot of research into how one can deliver these kinds of molecules. But that being said, it's still really hard to deliver them tissue selectively. And that's something that I think there's a lot of attention on this right now. It's certainly something my own lab is engaging in, and as well as many others, is to think about how do you actually get these editing molecules into the cells where you want editing to occur, and preferably not into other cells, so that it can potentially cause any problems. So that's going to happen, I think, going forward. But something to think about, and this is something that I find myself thinking about a lot too. And I don't know the answer, but I think it's something worth considering. Is that it may become in the not too distant future, depending on how ongoing experiments with human embryos go, and you may know that's also going on in several countries at the research level, not for clinical use right now. And but if those experiments go well, and it turns out that these editing molecules work well in embryos, there may be increasing pressure to make modifications to human embryos, particularly in cases where there are really life-threatening genetic disorders that are in a family, where you have the opportunity to do editing potentially in a way that gets around this whole delivery problem, because you can do it in an embryo. And so the question will be, should we go there? Should we do that? And I can tell you from email that I have traffic virtually every day from families that are afflicted by genetic disease, there will be a lot of interest and pressure from patient groups to do that. And so we have to really give serious thought to that, because it in the end, it may be easier to deliver to an embryo than to an adult who's already gone through a lot of suffering.
Yeah, thanks, Jennifer. Actually, your answer already covered several questions related with the stem cells and germline editing. So move down to the next question. Actually, Dr. Shi can participate later. That's about GMO foods. And after the editing, how long the follow-up should be, and how you follow up that for any possible adverse effect? Yeah.
I think there's a misunderstanding about the safety of the GMO derived food, and actually they have to go through the general screening system and the safety test. So far there is no scientific report to say that GMO products is less safe than the so-called natural-grown food product. So I don't think this will be a major issue. For the GMO, the real issue is, will it affect the environment? And so that's the place we can debate for the traditional GMO, because it's really, the traditional technique really bring in the foreign gene, and sometimes it's antibiotic resistant gene. So you do have to do the environmental safety test as assessment before you really want to grow in the field. But so far, I think there are, especially US National Academy of Science published a white paper this year, and to say the several major large scale study didn't show any, say, environmental effect of the GMO product, GMO crop, compared to the so-called traditional crop. But for the CRISPR-based, I think there's a room for debate whether it's really a GMO, because you only change the base, the several nucleotide, sometimes like that. So I think for CRISPR, it's so promising because it's create less concern compared to the traditional GMO technology. This will be my answer.
Jennifer, you want to add anything?
Nope, I think you said it all. It was, yeah.
Xinjian, yeah.
I just said, coming from UC Davis, of course, you know how I feel. That UC Davis was the early institute that started the GMO, and certainly the CRISPR has been well received there, and I agree with what you said.
Mm. I see, here's an interesting question about using this new technology. What is the biohazard or environmental perspective we should pay more attention? For example, biohazard, or how you take care of your biohazard, bio waste in your lab, and what should we set up a standard for the future, the GTP, GLP laboratory for? Yeah, is there any comment about that? I think that's a very good question, yeah.
Yeah, so I think this really comes up again when you think about using gene editing in organisms where you're making changes to their germ cells, right? Where you can create organisms that are going to be transmitting genetic modifications over, you know, many generations. And so I guess the application that really comes to mind when you ask the question is about something called gene drives, which you may have heard of, which basically means taking a gene editing technology like CRISPR that's very efficient and basically setting it up in such a way that it can be propagated through, it can propagate a trait through a population very quickly. And you may know that this has already been demonstrated in laboratories, in yeast, and in fruit flies. And there's now a lot of discussion about using this to propagate traits through insects like mosquitoes, so they would be unable to transmit disease, which is a way, sounds like a really great thing to do potentially, but it also has risk because it means that we might be releasing into the environment organisms that are going to be propagating a particular genetic trait over many, many generations, and what the long-term effects of that might be in the environment, how that might affect other organisms, animals that prey on those for food and things like that, what effects those might have. So the National Academy of Sciences in the U.S. has recently released a report about gene drives and sort of thinking about safety mechanisms there. And there's been a recent call from a division within the Department of Defense in the United States called DARPA for proposals that will address this very issue of the safety of gene editing and use in organisms that are released in the environment. So there's definitely a lot of interest in this and a lot of discussion about it. There's no easy answer, but again, I think it's something where, you know, right now we're sort of asking scientists to be proceeding in a responsible way while the technology proceeds, hopefully to the point where there are safety mechanisms that one can put in place to shut off a gene drive or shut it down if it turns out to be harmful.
Yeah, thanks, Jennifer. We have lots of questions related with the risk, hazard, and the safety issue. Now is several questions talk about aging issues. So from your experiments, did you ever see CRISPR-Cas9 can help the block aging, anti-aging, telomere, telomerase changes. Yeah, maybe Xinjian can contribute that. That means the long life from risk to life. So you can see the optimistic versus pessimistic here. Yeah.
Boy, the older I get, the more I care about that. I don't have an easy answer to that. I guess my thinking there is that, you know, like for many other kinds of applications, I think this editing technology will be very useful in the short term as a research tool for understanding the aging process better. Not necessarily in humans directly right away, but certainly in many other kinds of organisms, because now you can make modifications to genes very quickly and assess their effects. But beyond that, you know, in the end, will it be possible to introduce genetic modifications that somehow alter the aging process? Your guess is as good as mine. You know, I don't know. I think it really will come down to can we get a handle on the genetics of aging sufficiently to enable this kind of technology to come to bear on it. But I'm curious about what my colleagues think of this.
I think CRISPR technology really, just as Jennifer said, is actually really wonderful tool in knocking out genes, knocking in genes in a way that has not been able, that the scientists have not been able to do. So in terms of discovery of anti-aging gene, this is a very, very powerful tool. Now in terms of longevity, of course, in C. elegans study, and in mouse study as well, there are certain genes, PEPCK gene, for example, or people know that if you inhibit mTOR using rapamycin, you can increase the lifespan for the organism. So there are a few genes contributing to longevity or lifespan that have been uncovered in recent years. And of course, the CRISPR can be part of the way that eventually help this way. But I'm still thinking that the most powerful thing that CRISPR has just in the past 4 years really caught the entire scientific community by firestorm is that it's a speed and the precision. It can allow you to uncover genes. So in many of the companies, I just attended a meeting on CRISPR, and are using this to identify, for example, synthetic lethality of drug-resistant cell line in a way that's very difficult to do using either shRNA or other method. And the shRNA method and the CRISPR RNA, maybe Jennifer, correct me if I'm wrong, actually somewhat complementary. They may not hit exactly the same target. There's some overlapping, but not necessarily all the same. So this really introduced a very, very powerful way from the basic science to uncover things related to translation, to therapy. But also, I like to point out that in terms of regulation of the ethics part, you know, this has been there for a long time. When the molecular cloning was first introduced, there's a Asilomar meeting. They already started. And so I actually have more confidence in scientists that they can self-regulate. So through all these years, that's 1976, I believe. So here we have already about, 50, 40 years that we haven't really seen too much change in terms of human race, even though you can see there could be some. A company want to do something crazy, or not even company. But overall, I think scientists can really self-regulate itself. So CRISPR is just giving you a new way of doing that. But in terms of this, you know, the cloning, the cell cloning at the time, there was also an issue whether that would change your organism, and there were some possibilities. And people can do it. But I truly believe the scientists or medical scientists will, we have our conscience, we self-regulate ourselves.
Yeah. I like answers both from Jennifer and Xinjian, because I'm to I'm going to say, because I'm old enough to live through several hype by we molecular biologists, like the gene therapies, and we are going to cure cancer. I think that's probably 20 years ago. So just personally, I would just like to believe CRISPR is a terrific tool to do basic science. Anything come out is a bonus. And like biological process tend to be more complicated than we thought. So like the aging development, even cancer, I think we have a long way to go. That's my thought on this question.
Okay, follow up several questions actually I put to one. The question is why bacteria has such a smart protein like a Cas9 in attacking against protect the virus attacked? Why human did not have that? Yeah, and if we have, and then we can avoid the HIV. Or since there is a spontaneous remission HIV, could that be possible? These kind of person, they do have the Cas9 equivalent. And that's a very smart question here, but put all together.
Yeah, great questions. First, I have a few thoughts about this. First of all, a CRISPR type adaptive immune system doesn't seem to be present in humans. That doesn't mean it's not there, but we haven't found it yet. So, I always like to keep an open mind. I don't think negative results prove something. They just tell you haven't found it yet. But that being said, I think there are reasons to think that human cells might not have this kind of thing, and there might be a reason why, and that is that, as you probably some of you know, human cells have so-called innate immunity, which means that there's really quite a sophisticated set of proteins that are involved in detecting foreign nucleic acids that get into cells and turning on pathways that fight them. And my lab, in a very small way, has looked into this, but many researchers are doing really phenomenal work to understand how innate immunity works. And the thinking is that that's really a kind of a fairly ancient type of immunity in humans. And then, of course, we all have in our bodies, we have an adaptive immune system of our own, which is based on antibodies that develop to pathogens and then are maintained over time. So you get immunity to a particular type of pathogen, and that can be maintained over your lifetime. It just may be the case that an RNA-based adaptive immune system like CRISPR is just not needed, because we, in a way, have more sophisticated ways of fighting pathogens. But I don't know if my colleagues have other thinking on that.
Xinjian, maybe you are the virologist. I'm not, so, yeah.
Actually, I really don't know. I think that if you have a Cas9 protein always in the cell, it can harbor. I don't know. Maybe it's too complicated. It will cease. Just like what Jennifer said, if you have Cas9 always inside the cell as an integrated gene, there are certain uncertainty there. Therefore, Stephen Lin and Jennifer is using protein with RNA, so it's a transient. So with a Cas9 system, long-lived, or even as a part of the gene, it may recognize too many things. It's certainly very complicated, right?
Yeah, I think, it's hard to give the complete answer, but at least in part. Another question is an interesting question. I don't know why you people is really great here. Yeah, so if we inject a CRISPR-Cas9 into the single cell before the implantation. And then can you see they divide it by 2 by 4, they still have an equal distribution, the same amount of CRISPR-Cas9 in each egg? Wow, good question, I don't know. That means they just go by exactly the DNA replications, or they may have an even imbalance in DNA. I don't know. Yeah.
I think that, you know, work that I'm aware of that's going on in mice, for example, doing editing in embryos or in eggs, suggests that it really depends on the way that the Cas9 is delivered to those cells, as well as to the timing of the delivery. So if it's delivered in the form of a nucleic acid, like a DNA that encodes the protein, there's a period of time required for that DNA to be transcribed into a messenger RNA, and then the messenger RNA to be translated into protein. And that can mean that it takes a while for editing to begin, as well as, you know, that nucleic acid may be hanging around for a while, generating protein over time, so you can get editing occurring even as early embryogenesis is occurring. And so what that all means is that you can have a situation where you get a chimeric animal. So some of the cells have been edited and some of them haven't in the resulting animal. And I think that, I have a colleague, Lin Ho at Berkeley, who's published a recent, very nice paper called, she calls it CRISPR-EZ, which is a strategy using RNA and protein-based delivery into mouse embryos. And there, you know, they get a lot much higher rates of editing that occur very, very early because you're delivering a pre-assembled editing complex into these embryos. And she sees lower levels of this kind of chimerism. So I don't know if I quite answered your question, but I think, you know, it's something that people are really thinking hard about because, again, you know, whether you're using this for research purposes or whether you're thinking down the road to potential clinical use of this, this is going to be a really important issue is, you know, can you ensure that editing occurs when and where you want it and in the cells where you want it to happen? And if you're trying to generate a transgenic animal, of course, you'd really, I think, in most cases, you'd like to have that animal be homogeneous for the change that you're introducing.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, and this question, she put actually too many questions here, okay? But let me, some has been have been answered, but there's a few questions that are still worth it to be raised and discussed. Because a human genome defect and not always is a single mutation or single defect. So when you deliver CRISPR-Cas9, are you going to deliver the multiple different kind, or when they recognize several different lesions, they have any preference, affinity, binding difference? Yeah. So.
Yeah, more great questions. Well, I think on the one hand, this is one of the really enticing things about this technology is that as this questioner clearly appreciates, you know, it's a technology that can be, this protein can be programmed with multiple different guide RNAs in the same experiment or even in the same cell. And that was, I think, really beautifully shown initially by Rudy Janisch at MIT, who was able to use up to five different guide RNAs in a single mouse embryo editing experiment to show that he could introduce five changes to the genome of that organism in one shot. You know, the efficiencies obviously can differ depending on the target site that's being recognized. So you can't ensure that every cell will get all the same, you know, five sets of edits. And furthermore, this kind of touches on another, I think, important point, and I really would say future challenge of this technology is really in ensuring the type of DNA repair that happens after Cas9 makes a cut. Because as you saw in my talk, or you may know already, this is really the way this technology really works is it relies on Cas9 to introduce a double-stranded DNA break, but then it relies on the cell to do the repair. And that's where some heterogeneity can happen, right? Because the repair could happen differently in different cells. And so I think going forward, this is really one of the kind of bleeding edges of the technology is really to understand how cells conduct repair and how we can maybe manipulate that or control that, and also figuring out what are the different efficiencies of different guide RNAs, depending on which might depend on sequence, it might depend on the context of the chromatin where editing is occurring, and perhaps other things too.
Thanks. Another question is about this. Is there any limitation of the CRISPR-Cas9 function, such as like a length of the DNA, structure of the DNA, or et cetera?
Well, you know, people have looked hard for things like, you know, does DNA methylation affect editing? It does not seem to. There were two recent papers published that showed that that the position of nucleosomes in chromatin can affect editing efficiencies, although I would say that you know, from what many labs have seen, it really depends on the timing of editing. So if cells are going through multiple cell divisions where chromatin structure is certainly changing, then that can afford more opportunities for editing to occur and efficiencies, you know, go up. So, you know, I guess the short answer is yes, there definitely are effects of the chemical and structural state of the DNA on editing, but in the long run, you know, if depending on how the experiment is conducted, people really haven't seen, you know, real inhibitions of editing, just changes in relative efficiencies.
Xinjian or Dr. Xi, you want to comment?
I don't know if the question is related to the delivery or that. In terms of the vector that can deliver, Cas9 pretty large, but now I think there are some Cas9 which is smaller. And so there was some discussion whether you use AAV, the associated virus, and how much you can accommodate. I'm not sure this is the question, but in terms of the size of the sgRNA plus Cas9, you can use different plasmids. You can use the same plasmid. So there were tricks you can overcome the size limit. I'm not sure that was a question, but in terms of delivery, there's a technical difficulty.
Now, another interesting question is about when you use the CRISPR-Cas9 for knock-in versus knock-out gene editing, do you see any the difference in efficacy or any rate limit or anything? So they are looking at the in and out to see what's the difference.
Yeah, so knockouts are definitely generally a lot more efficient than knock-ins, because the repair required in each case is different. So in many cells, generating a small insertion or deletion at the site of double-stranded break repair, it occurs with much higher efficiencies and frequencies than recombining in a new piece of DNA, which would be a knock-in. So that's something that, again, it's really an important area of technology development. Many labs working on this right now, figuring out ways to do that more efficiently so that knock-ins, we hope, will eventually be as efficient as knockouts, and we can really control whether a knock-in is occurring or not, depending on how we employ the technology.
Yeah, the similar question, actually, I believe they sit side by side. Yeah, he asked about, by theory, do you think the off-target phenomenon would be more being seen in the knock-in, because that would be harder, yes, supposedly be harder, right?
Yeah. I don't know the answer to that question. I think, you know, again, I think it really comes down to where the DNA breaks are being introduced in the first place. So certainly I think what people have seen is that when you have an off-target event, typically that is manifested by a small disruption in the DNA sequence rather than aberrant integration of a new sequence. But that, again, that could just be a matter of efficiencies, right? Because typically the off-targets are really at much lower efficiencies than any on-target event. And so then by nature, you know, the efficiency of a knock-in at that off-target site would also be at much lower efficiency. You might just not observe it.
Thank you. Another interesting question. When you put your CRISPR-Cas9 into the cells, how long you can trace that this system still in the cell? On the other word, the pharmacokinetic, yeah. So I don't know. And following the question is, what is the system to get rid of? Ubiquination or anything else? Yeah.
So the lifetime, in experiments that we've been doing in the lab, again, Stephen Lin, who started this work in my lab, is doing, is using direct introduction of pre-assembled protein RNA complexes for editing. And there, what we see in other labs like Jin-Soo Kim in Korea and others have seen is that the lifetime of those complexes is roughly 24 hours, depending on the type of cell. So that's, you know, certainly sufficient to allow time for editing to occur and then for the complex to be degraded. As to the mechanism of degradation, we don't really know how that works. And I think that's actually, it's a very interesting question to understand that. We've done some work in the lab. Brett Stahl in my lab has been looking at the lifetime of these complexes when you inject into a mouse, just to see, you know, if you inject into the mouse bloodstream, how long do these complexes stick around? And what we see there is that you first see evidence for clipping and cutting of the guide RNA in places where it's actually protruding from the protein, if you look at the actual structure. And then degradation sort of proceeds from there. So we'd love to understand that mechanism better, because again, if you wanted to prolong the lifetime in serum, you might like to understand how that breakdown is happening. But that's something for the future.
Any discussants would like to contribute to this? No? No, yeah. I have to say, this audience is fantastic. Yeah, they really raised lots of good question. Since Dr. Stephen Lin's name been mentioned three times, I wonder, Dr. Lin's here? Yeah. No?
Oh. He's back in his lab doing research.
I see. If he's here, I would like to get his opinion about that as well. Yeah, okay. Okay, this question said, why bacteria willing to take these virus DNA and insert repeatedly, and what is the mechanism to make that possible, and how long this repeats can go? Are they random? Are they specific? Yeah.
Yeah, this is a really fun sort of cool aspect of CRISPR biology, is how these sequences are inserted into the genome and what maintains these arrays. And in the lab, we've done a lot of work on this, many other labs contributing as well. And what's understood currently is that there's a special CRISPR integrase, an enzyme complex whose job is to find bits of viral DNA. They're probably produced during the initial injection of DNA into the cell by the virus. And then that integrase binds to little, sort of basically grabs onto these little pieces of DNA and catalyzes the chemistry required to insert them into the CRISPR array. And in terms of regulating the length of those arrays, really not clear how that works. It turns out that in bacteria, and people like Jill Banfield, who are looking across, you know, large populations of different kinds of bacteria and comparing what's happening in different cells of those organisms, find that, you know, the arrays ranged in length from a single integration event, so one viral bit that's been integrated between two copies of the repeat, all the way up to arrays that have many dozens of such sequences. And how they are eventually lost from the genome is also really unclear. So there must be some mechanism for that, otherwise they could eventually take over the whole genome, and they don't. So there has to be some way that cells are able to lose old spacers that presumably, old viral sequences that presumably become, useless to the cell at some point in time. But how that works is not yet known.
Thank you. Any discussions want to chip?
Question for Jennifer. The CRISPR integrase you mentioned, do they look like a lambda integrase?
Nope, it has a novel structure.
Oh.
But it's a structure that, so we have, you know, there are crystallographic structures now of this, and it does not look like any known integrase, interestingly, or known anything else. It's really a unique protein fold. But it has a chemical mechanism that is very similar to HIV integrase.
I see. Another good question. Since CRISPR has a class 1, class 2, and several types, and also we know Cas has a correspondent Cas come out like a C2, C1, etc. So is that possible, or what do you see in the future about this field? Are they going to have a certain target based on this combination, or certain combination run a several specific target for responsible for certain disease? Do you have any thoughts about that? Mm.
I guess if I understand the question, I think you're asking, you know, that there are all these different types of CRISPR systems, and are there going to eventually be collections of these types of enzymes that will be of use for particular kinds of disease? Is that, mm-hmm. yeah?
Yes, yeah.
Absolutely. I, you know, my fantasy, and I don't think it's really a fantasy, I think it's happening, you know, is that over time, more and more of these types of enzymes will be uncovered and characterized, and eventually we'll have sort of a whole toolbox of different variations on this theme of RNA-guided enzymes that do interesting chemistry. And depending on the application that you have in mind, whether you want to target DNA, you want to target RNA, and the type of experiment that you want to do, or the type of clinical use you might have in mind, you can pick that version of the enzyme that is most appropriate. Whether it's, you know, you want to use it for viral delivery, you know, you might want to use a smaller variant, or if you want to target RNA, you might use a different enzyme. So I think that's one of the really fun and exciting things about these pathways, is that they really offer nature's solution to all of that type of engineering. It's right there. We have to just go find these enzymes.
Next question is, I think she's looking for a job. Well, I think you can find Dr. Donald's email and send it to her directly. I'm not going to be a middleman. Another interesting question here is, do you think in the future we should have a specialist like a gene therapist who can create the certain gene what you want and make you make more beautiful, taller, or whatever, weight control? I think that's very diversity, but I think this is a little bit like a fiction story, but I would like to get a comment. Since this is from first year student, so we should satisfy his question. Yeah.
They're pointing to me. Well, you know, I think, as I sort of mentioned at the end of the talk, I think that, it's really right now, today, that's really science fiction, in the sense that we just don't know enough about the human genome to be able to do that kind of thing, for the most part, even if we wanted to do it. But I do think that, you know, this is just my opinion, you know, I think it's coming. You know, maybe not tomorrow, maybe not next year, but, you know, I think it's coming, in the sense that, as you've heard in this conversation, you know, the thing about this technology is that it's really enabling research, and it's really increasing the pace of research just hugely, right? I mean, just phenomenally. And so that means that our collective ability to uncover the functions of genes and sets of genes has increased enormously. And so as we gain more and more insights into the genetic basis for human traits and human disease, there will be increasing desire to affect those genetic qualities. And so I think it's, you know, it's something that, I am really in favor of actively discussing this right now publicly, because I think we want people to become aware of this before it's really in our face and happening, right? I think we want to be really thinking about where we as a society want to, and globally, where we want to go with this kind of powerful technology.
Okay, since we want to attract people to work on PRIM biology, I can tell you what we are trying to do is, we hope in 10 or 20 years we can have so-called designer orchids. So you tell us what kind of flower, color, shape you want. In 3 years, we will give you this designer orchid. So I encourage you guys to come to work in the PRIM biology field.
Dr. Chen also would like to ask a question.
This is not related to science, but if 20 years you can have your own designer kit, then I would say in 50 years, every day you see each other, it's not WhatsApp or 你吃了没有, baby, do your DNA today?
Do your DNA today?
That actually is Jennifer's last family name, Dudna. Do you DNA?
Yeah, doubt not. Very interesting. Yeah. Yeah. So one more science question, then one more common question, and then we're going to end in 10 minutes. This science question is very interesting. The question is, if you deliver your CRISPR-Cas9 to the terminal end of the DNA or mid of the DNA, do they have any preference, particularly in the middle or toward the end of the DNA? Did you ever try that?
I think the answer is no. We haven't looked at targeting of say telomeres versus which would be the ends of chromosomes, human chromosomes or eukaryotic chromosomes versus the middle. But others have done this kind of thing, and I'm not aware of any systematic differences in editing that are observed with that kind of application.
Actually, it's on the same question sheet about whether the DNA double strand break versus single strand break. Are they show this using the same technology? Do they show any different preference or any efficacy difference? Yeah.
Well, so with single stranded breaks, it looks like there are some DNA repair pathways, of course, that you know will repair those breaks, but. But for the most part, when people try to use these types of technologies like CRISPR for conducting editing, they do it by introducing a double-stranded break. And so if they're using CRISPR in a form where it introduces just a single stranded break to DNA, then they use it in pairs. So you still get a double-stranded break, but you can introduce it the break with a staggered cut, which can in principle influence the way repair occurs. I think, again, to me, that's really an exciting area for future research, is to be able to understand how the nature of the DNA break that's introduced could influence the way that repair occurs.
Yeah, all these questions we raised above can be 20 years work, right? But I'm so glad that the audience here is really phenomenal. So our last question, I promise for this graduate student year two. This is a career life question. It's when you met with Dr. Emmanuel Charpentier, you think about combining this two RNA CRISPR and transacting RNA two together as a currently we call progressing editing technology. What are you getting inspired or just serendipitously think about this, or you try many way very hard and then find out this is the best? What your thinking process and how much effort you put it in? And this is for PhD students. Yeah. Hard work, of course, over the weekend. Yeah. Don't say I say that.
Well, I really have to credit Martin Jinek in my lab with this, because you know he is a wonderful biochemist and structural biologist. He was doing a lot of the original research on our end on this system, and as a good biochemist does, he was trying to figure out what are the minimal components that are necessary for RNA-guided DNA cleavage to occur as catalyzed by the Cas9 protein. And so as part of that effort, he took the natural CRISPR RNA and tracer RNA sequences that are generated in bacteria and started trimming away at bits of those RNA, both of those RNA molecules. And that eventually led to a realization that these RNAs, you know, if you included the elements necessary for Cas9 binding and DNA recognition, that you could actually, you know, trim these molecules down to fairly minimal levels. And then that was sort of I can remember this very well. There was just this incredible day sort of in my life and in my science life for sure, when he was in my office showing me these data and sketching out on my whiteboard, you know, what this complex might look like. This was, of course, before we had any structural, you know, crystallographic data or anything. And we were thinking about this, and you know, sort of looking at these sketches, realized that these RNAs could be linked together potentially. And so he tried doing this in a couple of different ways, actually made several different variations of this, and was actually in that case able, because I think he already had so much biochemical information, was able to fairly quickly show that several of the ideas that he had for linking them together were actually productive. And so there was a, you know, this kind of this, that for me, that when I think back on it, that for me that was kind of the moment when the project went from being a curiosity driven kind of fun, you know, how do bacteria fight viruses kind of project, to being something where we looked at each other and said, you know, this could be an amazing technology, because now this is a two component system that could be introduced into cells and used very easily for RNA guided DNA cutting.
Thank you. Thanks, Jennifer. I know I missed so many questions here. I apologize. If you have any further question, maybe just be a PhD student and learn by yourself. And because the time issue and the Dr. Donald's are going to catch the fly. So I appreciate your time. Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you to all of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, President Yan. Thank you again for our host, Dr. Donna, and all our panelists. Please, I'd like to invite our guest on stage for a group photo.